Church, happy Easter. We're so glad you're here to worship with us, to celebrate our risen King. Come on, let's worship Him together this morning. Do you see what I see? Do you see what I see? Thank you.
Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone, Messiah still and all alone. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh, Lord, oh, Lord our God. And on the sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints, my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face.
My name is Janelle. I've been liberated from shame to experiencing joy. In 2008, I started experiencing pain in my arms and my hands. It became very extreme to the point where I couldn't use them anymore. So this literally just flipped my world upside down. I was a hired musician, a piano player, or am a piano player, and a piano teacher. So I had to quit my work. And at that time, I had 4 children between the ages of 5 and 11. I ended up being in bed for almost 3 years, bedridden. We had to make huge changes as a family, and it was really, really tough. With chronic pain comes words that are associated, like, I'm not valuable. I'm limited. I'm not useful. And I'm to blame. I start to believe that it was my fault. So my prison was just my mindset that that held me captive. This last summer, Dave was on sabbatical and we got to go to the UK. We went just north of London to a Bible camp. This one session, the speaker talked about just the destructive names we call ourselves. And immediately, I got the name I call myself. And the destructive name was, I'm chronic pain. Like, I titled myself chronic pain. I went up for prayer. And the lady started to pray for me for this title of chronic pain that I held. I didn't realize at that time that I needed healing for my mind as well. I thought this was all a physical thing, and I hadn't realized that I had taken on shame and guilt. She all of a sudden stopped, and the Spirit was leading her to change her prayer for me. And the prayer was, and God, we just pray that in your name, that Janelle would not have any more shame and guilt on her because she felt like she couldn't be the mother she wanted to be, because she couldn't be the person she wanted to be, or the wife, or the friend. And so God, we just pray that that shame, that guilt would be released. And do you know what? Immediately I had just this internal cry. Well, actually it was more than internal, it was physical, but like this deep pit in my stomach and this cry that just was bursting out. I was wailing and I was being liberated from shame and guilt. Immediately I was free. I was light. I didn't feel this heavy burden on me anymore. And all of those words that used to always be coming around my mind in any case, any scenario of my day, just my practical day, I'm free of. Those words do not exist in my brain anymore. I don't have them. I actually feel like God has given me a purpose with my pain. I know that when I'm in pain, I need to even come to Him more so that He can carry it with me. He doesn't leave me. That's really important for me to know, that I'm not alone in this, and I can look to Him as a child that is so loved, and that it's not my fault, and I'm free of that. Another part to it is just that I feel like I can start to really, when my pain is higher, it's my cue that God's saying, pray for everyone else that's got pain, Janelle. Pray for the world because I'm brokenhearted for them. I have just a peace and a joy. my family notices it. I notice it because the name I now call myself is Christ's precious child. That is my name. He's completely liberated me, and I am free from all guilt and shame. And He has done this for all of us. It's for all of us to have.
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer a slave to fear, for I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear, I am a child of God. Chosen me, love has called my name. I've been born again to your family. Your blood flows through my veins, and I'm no longer a slave to fear, for I
I'm no longer
Hello, my name is Gene, and I've been liberated from emptiness. This is my story. Well, I did believe in God, but kind of like from a distance. But the fact that I affirmed God's existence had no impact, no meaning, basically, in my life. I was looking to live an adventurous life, and pleasure was going to be that vehicle. So I needed to be free. So the last thing I wanted was moral constraints from a God. The greatest expression of freedom came back in 1980 when the male exotic industry was becoming very popular. So I decided to check it out, and it so happened it was amateur night. So I went in an audition, and lo and behold, I got the job. I was living this dream. And I lived it for 15 years. The wine, the women, the song, the money, the drugs, it was constant flow. But like anything, it takes a toll. You know, it's like when you're in a room full of people and you feel lonely. There's that emptiness. It's hard to describe. It's even hard to assess it because I never experienced that. Here I had everything the world had to offer. But at some point, it wasn't satisfying anymore. In that emptiness, and as I was sensing that spiritual hunger, I didn't really know where to turn. Basically dialing through the radio stations, and I did come on upon a Christian radio station. And that began to have more satisfaction. I wanted to satisfy and nurture that hunger because that brought contentment. I was at peace. It was exhilarating, if I can use that word. So had you walked in the hallways of my mind back then, it would not have been a family-friendly place. But you see, God has liberated me from the depths of my depravity. The mind's been renewed and restored. There is this peace that rests upon you. Because as you get to know God, that He loves you, provides for you, He has plans and purpose. You know, random living, aimless, going to work, and blah, 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 watching TV, et cetera, et cetera. No. There is a purpose. I've been truly liberated from those ugly pursuits that ended up in dead ends. And now that I get to be with the family of God, I mean, Sunday's my favorite day. I mean, I just love hanging around just because God's given me this love for people. This is a forever family. Frankly, Jesus liberated me from this humdrum existence, dead end road, to a life that not only is purposeful, but it is joyful because of the Spirit of the living God. Has taken up residence in me. And I'm His child. I belong to Him. There's nothing better than that.
Well, it's the celebration of Easter, the liberation from death to life. This is what John writes at the very end of his gospel. He says, these accounts are recorded so that you might know that Jesus is the anointed one, that He is the liberating King, the Son of God, because believing grants you the life that He came to share. And because Jesus rose from the grave, you and I get to experience freedom from any prison that encloses us. And this was Mary's experience. Early on that Sunday morning, well before the dogs and the roosters were even awake, she and a couple other friends gather the spices that they've collected and they make their way to the garden tomb. They want to embalm the body of their friend Jesus. But their problem is that between them and the body, there's a big stone that's put that body in a graveyard prison. That stone is there to kind of keep the stench out and to keep the rats from going in. But more than being worried about the stench, they're worried about who's going to help them move that stone. Because that's what graves do. That's what prisons do. They're designed to keep death kind of inside and life from really entering. And maybe you, I've not been in a prison with bars or razor wire, but maybe you know the other kind of prisons, the prisons like Janelle, that's like me, that experience kind of those debilitating thoughts. Am I good enough, or what can I do? Or prisons like Jean's, who wonder, is anybody going to love me, and am I going to be alone? Or the prison of a treadmill of always trying to find a new thing that'll make us feel valuable or worthy. Or maybe it's a prison of anxiety, wondering about all the what ifs that will happen, or the prison of kind of discouragement and despair where you're hardly even able to hope. Can you even hope to hope? And here is Mary and these other women on their way to a tomb, and their hearts begin to get a little lighter though when they see that the stone is not there. And as they get closer, they think someone has helped us to get to be able to embalm the body of Jesus. But when they look actually into the tomb, there's no people to help them. There's no body. There's no one. And all of a sudden, they're in a prison of just discouragement and hopelessness. We came to embalm a body, and we can't even find that body. And so they rush back and they find a couple of Jesus' friends, or disciples we might call them, and Peter and John come rushing to the grave, and they look inside that little cave and there's nothing there. Peter is so confused. John thinks maybe some of Jesus' promises have come to pass. But eventually they all leave and Mary's left alone, isolated, just her and her thoughts. There are a number of Marys that show themselves in the Gospels. In fact, there are five altogether. We don't know a lot about any of them, and we know very little about this Mary, except she was called Mary of Magdalene, or meant that she was from Magdala, this small little community on the seaside port of the Sea of Galilee. It was a community that was a mix of Jewish and Gentile people, and because of that, it was an anything goes kind of community. It was like what happens in Magdala kind of stays in Magdala. And she, we're told, had seven demonic spirits. Seven things, imagine, that was kind of controlling her life. She was out of control. And we don't know exactly what that meant. It's just maybe that was rage, or maybe that was anxiety. Maybe that was sensuality, that there were these things in her life she couldn't get control of, and most likely was impoverished and isolated and rejected by people. She probably sought support and sought help, and there was no way she could fix herself until she meets Jesus. And perhaps one day Jesus calls her by name and says, Mary, and those seven spirits leave. And because of him, she becomes a brand new person. She is free. She's finally able to live and walk and have community with other people and live with purpose in her life. And out of gratitude, we're told that she and a few other women kind of traveled with the disciples, and that they were maybe there helping them, making their life easier, maybe providing some financial support for them. Because imagine 12 guys traveling on their own for a couple years, probably not the best. Now, I know there's some people that would say, oh, Mary of Magdala, maybe she and Jesus had a relationship. There's no information that would say this. But here she is now, back sitting alone, isolated, and not ready to see what's going to happen next. And as we pick up the story, we read that Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. And as she wept, she stooped to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had lain, one at the head and one at the feet. And they said to her, woman, why are you weeping? And she said to them, well, they've taken away my Lord, and I don't know where they have laid him. And so as Mary is there crying outside the tomb, she does what we often do when we lose something. We retrace her steps. We go back and look. She thinks the body was there. The body must be there. It has to be there. And she goes, peeks in, maybe hope beyond hope that she'll find the body or looking for a clue. But this time she sees something no one saw before. There was an angel sitting at the head of where Jesus' body had been laid, at the foot of where Jesus' body had been laid. And they begin to speak to Mary. And these angels ask her a question. Why are you weeping? Now, I don't know about you, but if you take that as a question, that's probably the dumbest question of the day. This is a graveyard. Why would she not be weeping? Would you ask that question to someone at a cemetery? If you walked into a funeral home and someone was crying, would you ask them why they are weeping? You know why they are weeping. And that's what she says. You don't know what's happened to my life. They've taken my friend. They've taken my Lord. They've taken the teacher. They've taken the one who meant so much to my life. And now he's gone. And look at me. I don't know what to do next. Because being with Jesus had given her a sense, a presence. She had a community. She was there with followers of people, and now she felt very much alone. Not only had they left and abandoned her, but she's now isolated. Where does she go? Where does she turn? She had no other community. And Jesus had somehow given her a purpose. She was to help care for people. She was to help support the work, the way that Jesus was doing. And now, what was she going to do? She had one purpose, to kind of embalm the body that day. And now, well, even that was taken from her. And as she sat there weeping, like we do sometimes, she no doubt felt completely powerless. I don't know where to turn. I don't know what to do. I don't even know what to take a next step. And if I did, I don't know how to take it. Why am I weeping? It's obvious. But maybe it wasn't a question. Maybe it was a gentle rebuke to Mary. Mary, why are you weeping? Do you realize where you are? Do you realize what took place here? Do you realize what people are about to experience? Do you realize that Jesus had promised that he would rise and this has happened? Do you realize you're at the place that people in time immemorial would wish they could go back to and see and look at? Mary, why would you weep? You're not in a place of death anymore. You're in a place of life. But in her prison of discouragement and aloneness and despair and powerlessness, she couldn't see it. And maybe you can't see right now all that God's doing around you, because she missed the picture that these angels were portraying. And when you notice what it says, it's very clear. Two angels, one at the head, one at the foot, looking in together. That's very much like a picture we see in the Old Testament again and again and again. That on this instrument of worship that God had constructed, it's called the Ark of the Covenant. It was a big box. It was covered with gold. Inside there was some manna. There were the tablets of the Ten Commandments. There was a branch, a rod of Moses. Inside there were elements of what God had done in the past. And then on the lid, there were two angels, one at the left, one at the right, looking at each other. And in the center was the mercy seat. It was the place that people could come and receive mercy, where God would say, hey, leave your burdens here. Let me do a work. Now, that Ark of the Covenant was only in the Holy of Holies, the one place of the temple that one priest, one day a year, could go to. It wasn't accessible to everybody. But what happens? A tomb is open. There are two angels, mercy in the middle, and Mary now has access, liberation for the mercy of God. Now, what I find fascinating is almost every other time in the Bible an angel appears, people are freaking out. Right? They're falling on the face. The first thing the angel always says is, hey, don't be afraid, but not Mary. right? Why are you weeping? She sees these two angels. Is she freaked out? No, she's so immersed in her own pain. But it's almost like the peace of this moment is an invitation to all of us to come and experience the liberating, freeing mercy of Jesus. Just come. He invites us to come. We are there. And so there is Mary sitting and weeping and not really seeing the fullness of the moment. And then she feels a presence behind her. And as the story continues, someone comes in from the other direction. And it said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I don't know where they have laid him." And having said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing, but she didn't know that it was Jesus. And Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?" And supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you have laid him and take me there." And Jesus said to her, "Mary." And she turned and said to him in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. And Jesus said to her, "Don't cling to me, for I've not yet ascended to the Father, but go to my brothers and tell them, I'm ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." And Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I've seen the Lord," and that he had said all these things to her. So as she's kind of confounded by this picture with the angels, Jesus, although she doesn't know him, kind of creeps up at the back and asks that confounding question again, "Mary, why are you weeping?" "It's a cemetery," she says. "The deceased are here. This is a place of death. They've taken the body. I don't know where my friend is. Can you help me? Can you tell me?" And she, again, is so immersed in her pain and in her difficulty, she misses the gravity of the moment. Because just think, here is Mary in her pain. There's two angels in front of her and Jesus behind her. Angels in front of her, Jesus behind her, but what does she see? All she sees is her pain. All she sees is the sorrow. All she sees is the imprisonment of the frustration of what she's experiencing. And you know, we look back with the 2020 hindsight of a couple centuries and we may go, Mary, can't you see? Like Jesus is there. The angels there. God is there. God's work. God's for you. And yet how many times are we very much like Mary? That all we can see is just the pain and the difficulty and the frustration. And maybe that's you this Easter morning. All you can see is some pain or difficulty or maybe the impossibility of the situation. All you can see is that you feel that you can't move forward or backwards because there's no way to go, that you feel absolutely paralyzed or you're terrorized or you're not sure what to do and you miss God's angels in front of you and Jesus right there behind you. And maybe you're the one in need today of liberation from what you're experiencing. And all that, though, went away in one moment when Jesus says to Mary her name. He just says, "Mary." Maybe that's what Jesus said when he liberated her from the seven spirits. It's fascinating. Jesus knows our name. In fact, in the book of Isaiah, it says our name is like tattooed on the palm of God's hand. In the book of Revelation, it says that those people who overcome when we get to heaven, that we have a new name that Jesus gives us. It's written on a white stone. And when we get there, we're going to get a brand new name. Don't you wonder what God's going to name you or name me? In fact, in the book of Revelation, it also says that when we overcome and we get to see him, that Jesus is going to come and usher us down through all the courts of heaven, and he's going to introduce us and say, "Hey, this is my friend Terry. This is my friend Terry, and this is Terry. He knows me," and introduce us to the Father by name, and he calls Mary by name. And in that moment, she is liberated from the aloneness and powerlessness and despair that she has experienced. And I think in that moment, she realized that she was not only liberated from, you see, she had been liberated from those seven spirits. She now understands she's liberated for something. And Jesus is going to liberate her to experience three incredible things. And sometimes we think, oh, God's going to give us a life, or God's going to save me, God's going to rescue me, and I can just go on with my life, and oh, I don't have to worry about that together. But Easter, the celebration of Easter, reminds us that Jesus liberates you and I for something. First of all, we see that she is liberated for a relationship. She's liberated for the presence of Jesus to be with her forever. And this was Mary. She's alone. She's crying. And Jesus comes and says her name, and everything changes. And friends, sometimes we think Easter, it's an event. Easter's a moment. Easter's a powerful thing. Easter is a person. Easter is Jesus. It's a relationship with Jesus. And Mary experienced this. See, the problem is that there are things that kind of separate us from God. We're in our own prison. We would maybe call that a prison of sin, a prison of shame, a prison of dysfunction, a prison of messing up. That there are things that make it feel difficult to really connect with God. And maybe this morning you're like, yeah, I really would like to know God. Maybe someone's invited you, or you're watching with someone, but you're like, I don't think I'm good enough. I don't think I'm worthy. We would call that sin. The Bible would just call that sin. And Jesus came to die on the cross for that sin and rise again so that we could have a relationship, that nothing would block us from him. Now, I have three girls. When they were young, there was one Disney movie I never wanted them to watch. It was Monsters, Inc. Or Monsters University was the sequel. And Monsters, it talks about little kids right in their bedroom and these monsters that haunt them. And I'm like, why, Disney, would you teach my kids this? Why would you plant in their head that there are monsters in their closet? And so when my kids would say, hey, there's something in my closet, or I think there's something under my bed, we would go in and the same thing would automatically happen. That whenever an adult went in, whenever another presence went into the room, what happens? The monster flees. It doesn't seem so big. It's not there. And it's very true for us that our problems, our issues, our challenges, that they always seem so much bigger when we feel alone. Right? And people say, oh, it's going to be a bad day because I'm alone, or it's not going to go well because no one helps me. But if someone comes and walks with us, or someone comes and helps us, all of a sudden it changes. See, and this is what happens in our life. We can feel alone, or we feel powerless, or I can't change anything, or no one understands. But Jesus said, I will never leave you or forsake you. At the end of Matthew, he says, I want you to go into the world and make disciples. And he says, I'm going to be with you even to the ends of the earth. This is Easter, that Jesus is with us. He will never leave us. We are liberated from our sin and shame and guilt and pain so that we could have Jesus with us. Let me ask you, do you know Jesus' liberating power? Do you know the Father's love? Have you experienced that? You see, we will never know what real love is until we've experienced the Father's love. Have you experienced his love? Have you experienced Jesus' love? I loved Gene's story where he just talks, it's the orphan finding a family, right? It's the refugee finding a place to live. It's finding a home. And in a moment, we're going to give you an opportunity to respond. And maybe today, you just need to be reminded, God loves you. Would you let the Holy Spirit show you God's love? Second thing is that Mary realized she was liberated for a purpose. See, she had no purpose until Jesus freed her the first time. And then her purpose was to support Jesus and the work and the ministry. And then her purpose was to go and anoint the body. And on that morning, what was probably so devastating is the one thing she could do, the last thing she could do for Jesus, she couldn't do it. And when we don't have purpose, we don't have life. Right, there's something powerful about having a purpose. In fact, in Nazi Germany, in the Nazi prison camps, one of the ways that they would torture people in prison was that they would go and they'd have people dig a hole at point A, carry the dirt to point B, and then they'd take the dirt from point B and they'd go back and they'd fill in the hole. And then they dig it all up again and take it back to B, and then they put it in again, and they would spend weeks doing something that seemed absolutely purposeless, and people went crazy because they didn't have a purpose. But notice what Jesus does. He says to Mary, I want you to go and tell my brothers, tell the disciples that I am alive. Mary, you are the first witness. You're the first person to tell people. You're the one who is going to give this remarkable news. You see, John, when he peeked in the tomb, he thought, oh, maybe Jesus' promises were true. Maybe he did come back from the dead. But people don't know that someone rose from the dead unless they see the body, see the person. And Mary now has this message and a purpose. She says, I want you to go. This is amazing. Jesus said, I am returning to my Father. I want you to go and tell him I'm returning to my Father. He's your Father. He's your friend. He's my friend. And Jesus goes and gives her a purpose. See, there's something powerful about a purpose. Richard Brooks, a New York Times columnist, did one of the earliest of the TED Talks, and it is still one of the most watched. And his TED Talk was this: are you building a resume or a eulogy? He says, are you building just a resume of all the things that you feel kind of good at, or are you building a eulogy of lives changed or people impacted? And Jesus says, Mary, I want you to have a eulogy. And this is what God does. He gives us a reason. And he gives us the very same task, same purpose. He says, I want you to go and be my witness. What Mary did in saying, I saw Jesus, I want you to go and say, Jesus liberated me. And friends, this is what blew the church up, why people came and joined the church. It's because people said, I've seen Jesus. And sometimes we wonder, oh, is the resurrection just a myth? Is it just something nice? Is it maybe just a spiritual resurrection? Is it, oh, I know that Jesus is kind of a floating spirit with God. But what they saw was Jesus in the flesh personally. And why else would the disciples blow up their life? Why would they risk death? Why would they travel to different places? Why would they be crucified upside down for a myth or for something they didn't see, or they just made it up, or we just wanted Jesus alive? But because Mary and the other disciples saw him alive, they had purpose. Friends, we have a purpose, appointing people to Jesus. And I just love that when Janelle shared her story, that's it. She sees God using her. Even though God may not have healed her all physically, God is using her. And then Jesus gave her power. We are liberated from weakness on Easter to experience his unstoppable power. Notice what happens. Mary sees Jesus, finally realizes him. She grabs a hold of him, right? She's not going to let him go. She saw him die on the cross. She saw him, or Cain was looking for him in the tomb. She's not ever going to let him go again. But Jesus says what? Oh, don't touch me. Let go. Now, why would Jesus do that? It's because he says, I've not yet gone to the Father. See, Jesus had raised other people from the dead. He raised Lazarus from the dead. He raised Jairus' daughter from the dead. He raised some people from the dead. But they were going to what? They were going to die again. He raised them from the dead, but eventually they would die. Jesus wasn't raised from the dead, or let's call it resuscitated. He was resurrected from the dead. He was going to be alive in that form forever. We don't know exactly what he was like, but it says that eventually we will be like him. And he is going to what? Ascend to the Father. He says, don't touch me. I haven't ascended to my Father. I haven't sat on the throne. What's Jesus saying? I'm going to have a resurrected body that's powerful. And he said, I'm going to sit on the throne. And I'm going to be with my Father. And one day you will reign with me. And Jesus here reminded Mary of the power that we all would be able to experience. See, the problem is when we think of Jesus, we want a nice, safe Jesus, right? We want a Jesus just loves everybody. He's your best friend. He's going to hang out with you. He's a nice shepherd who's just going to pat the heads of his sheep. He's just a nice person. We forget, why did they crucify Jesus in the first place? It's because they were threatened by him, threatened by his power, threatened by his words, threatened by his miracles. And sometimes we need a Jesus who is small enough to kind of fit into the hurts of our life, but sometimes we need a Jesus who is more powerful than any other power on earth. We need a powerful Jesus who's going to help us. And friends, we can't always have it both ways. We can't just have a nice little Jesus. We need a powerful Jesus. And the amazing thing, all throughout the Bible, it says that God shares his power with us. And Paul writes in Ephesians 3:19, he says, I also pray that you will understand the incredible greatness of God's power. Do you know his power? Do you understand the greatness of his power? For those who believe, this is the same mighty power that raised Christ from the dead, seated him at the place of honor at God's right hand in the heavenly realms. And Paul says, the same resurrection power that raised Jesus from the dead. And I don't know what that looked like. If there was a light in the tunnel, if it blew the door off, if Jesus suddenly got up and he had strength to roll away the stone, I don't know. But the same power, Paul says, is available to you and I. And yet we live such powerful lives. We were not liberated on Easter morning for weakness. We are not freed from our guilt and sin for weakness. We are freed for power. And I know people again and again say, I don't have the strength. I can't do it. I don't have the strength to make this decision or to change or to do something. And Mary didn't have that strength either. She was there weak. And Jesus says, I want you to go be my witness. And she did that. You see, when we feel absolutely weak, we need only a power that's outside ourselves. We need a power that's greater than ourselves. And we don't have power to forgive our sins, but Jesus died to do that. We don't have power to be his witness, but Jesus will give us power to do that. We don't have power. And sometimes that's the place God takes us, to our very weakest and powerless place, so that his power is made perfect in us. You have been liberated for power. I invite you just to hear Kim's story. This is an incredible story. This is a reminder that Jesus rose from the dead to give you and I that same unstoppable power. Listen.
My name's Kim. I've been liberated from death. Here's my story. I found this lump on my neck and then got it diagnosed, and the doctor told me that it was lymphoma. He told me that there was a 97% chance of full recovery if I started chemotherapy right away, and that it's only going to take 3 months and then I can go back to my old life. So at the time, I felt shocked, obviously, devastated. My mom was beside me. But then at the same time, I felt a weird sense of relief because I was living such a torn life inside, and it was tearing me apart, and I really needed a stop, and cancer provided that pause. I reasoned with myself that, you know, if I just take chemotherapy, my body heals, but I would just go back to the same life again, and I would get sick again, and I can't change that. I can't change what I felt inside. And so I rejected chemotherapy. Every day I would wake up and try to see and touch my lymph nodes and see if they were getting bigger, and I would still be anxious and worried about whether I'm getting better. I used to weigh 150 pounds. I was down to 97. I was skin and bones. I had open wounds all over my body. The body won't heal itself, so it keeps on bleeding. I was coughing blood. The tumor was 15 centimeters cube. It was really big. And I couldn't breathe. My heart was like beating nonstop. So really bad physically. And then I lost my bar license. I drove my girlfriend at the time to depression. We broke up. And I was like this giant black hole in the family who sucked up all the joy. My mom saw how in such a terrible situation I was, and she was crying. She had been patient all the time, but she was crying that day. And she was like, hey, you have to go to the hospital. Like, if you don't, you're gonna die. I felt I was really at the end of myself. Like, I've tried everything I could. There's no more for me to give. And I was really desperate. There was this preacher who over the years was preaching Jesus to me, leading me through the Bible, caring for me. And she said, hey, Kim, we can arrange a baptism for you before you go to the hospital. Would you want to do that? And I said, yes. Before the baptism, before everyone came in, I had a moment with God and I just prayed to him. God, I am so tired. I'm so tired. I tried everything in my power. I used everything that I have, that I got. I gave it and it still didn't work. I can't even save my own life. I have nothing left now. Whatever is left, please take it. You're my only hope. I felt so loved by God and by the people who came, and I felt loved and I felt no shame. The day after baptism, I went to the hospital. At the time, I still really did not want to do chemotherapy because out of fear and out of pride. Very miraculously, he made me know that chemotherapy was the way that he has chosen for me to get healed. And he's asking me to trust him with something that I really did not want to do, but it was my first step of saying, okay, from this point on, I'm trusting God instead of myself. And once I made that leap of faith, I had so much faith and so much peace in the whole therapy and the whole treatment. And very, very fast, like I took chemotherapy and got stronger and stronger. And very soon I was like back to normal. And now like I'm liberated to this new path of life, this path of righteousness, this path of eternity. And I'm so grateful. I was liberated from death, physically and spiritually. I found peace, I found rest, I found love. And I now walk in the power of Christ.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Well, I'm sure that all of us sometimes feel like we're just broken. We're kind of laying there before God and we need Him to do something. Maybe you feel very alone this morning and you need to feel His presence. And would you just wait on the Holy Spirit and let the Holy Spirit give you just His friendship, the presence of Jesus? Maybe you're not sure what to do. Maybe you feel so gripped with shame or fear or discouragement. Or maybe you're thinking, everything I'm doing, it doesn't really have value. It feels more like I'm just building a resume in life. I want to have a eulogy. Maybe you just need to pray and come and ask God to do a work in your life. Maybe you feel powerless. See, this is the celebration of Easter. Jesus is the liberating King. He came to give us power, His unstoppable power. So I just invite you to come. If you're listening on Easter morning, just during the live replays of our service, there's someone in the chat that would love to pray with you, and we would love to pray. Would you not leave this place? Don't leave this service powerless or alone. If you're watching later on Easter Day or that week, then we encourage you, send a email us at our prayer link on our webpage. Let us pray with you. And if you've never experienced the liberating power of Jesus, if you've never experienced His forgiveness of sin, we invite you to do that now. You can say, hey, dear Jesus, I'm just weak, I'm powerless, I'm purposeless, I'm a sinner, I've messed up, I'm not really worthy of Your love, and many times I've just kind of rejected it. But I know, Jesus, You died and You rose again to free me from all the debilitating thoughts that I have. Jesus, come into my life, be Lord of my life, take charge of my life. Just as we reflect on this last song, invite someone to pray with you. Reach out in prayer. Would you come to the altar and let Jesus liberate you?
Was born with the precious. Thanks so much for joining us for Easter. Let us be sent and marked as people who have been liberated from and liberated for. What has God liberated you from, and what has God liberated you for? And if you're taking these steps with Jesus for the first time, we would love to join you in this. And we have prayer partners available in the chat right now that would love to pray with you as you begin this journey. So, church, happy Easter. Have a great week. Bye.